show you really big shit, far out and technical and stuff. Oh, so yeah. Come on and turn it on. Tune into the Tech Shamans. Come on and turn it on. Tune into the Tech Shamans. Come on and turn it on. Tune into the Tech Shamans. Come on and turn it on. Tune into the Tech Shamans. Cool.
Hey everybody, hello. Good morning. Welcome good morning. To Tech Shamans. It's Monday.
Already.
Yes. Okay. So before we get started, I got big news. And I hope Rob pulled the picture out of the Shamans thing. So as of yesterday, or last night at 9 p.m. on the nose, I have a second grandbaby.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Well done, John. Well done. Congratulations.
I can't say I did it. I didn't do anything.
You did something.
I love it. Yeah, I love when all of us dads get congratulated when we get kids. Oh, great job. I didn't do crap. I think I got 3 minutes into that.
No. Because these days.
Sorry.
Days, if you've made it the full 9 months and you're still married, you've done a lot.
That is true.
Yes, you have done a lot.
Holy crap. Yeah, I don't know. Maybe Rob will show
nobody needs your crap.
Show the picture of the baby here in a second. I don't know. I don't think
my God, it looks just like you, John.
Poor child.
Talking already?
Oh, my God.
Wearing Nerd Talk t-shirts?
That is not
you really planned
good.
This well.
But anyway.
Yes.
It was
at some point randomly there's going to be a baby pic in the middle of our conversation.
Well, I didn't tell him to do it. Right, I didn't ask him to do it. I don't tell him anything. I just ask him, hey man, if you can do it, man, that's great. If you can't,
there we go.
There it is.
We have a new Jedi.
Welcome to the Force.
You know the worst part for me was growing up as a kid. I read the book before I saw the movie or anything else, and for me they were Jedi Knights. I read the book. Okay. You know, long before I saw the movie. And so it took me forever to learn to say Jedi instead of Jedi.
Jedi Knights. Yeah. So anyway, very proud.
That would be an old nerd moment.
So SpaceX this morning got scrubbed.
Yep, SpaceX got scrubbed due to weather again. Well, it was actually on hold the whole time for weather. Every other system was fine to run, but then they finally said, nope, the clouds aren't breaking, kill it. And it was just heavily overcast was really the only issue. So they're sitting there ready to go.
Welcome to Flora.
He's got quite an agenda launching, 3,217 satellites or something.
That's a lot.
In the next week.
I'm not going to jump to that story first because we're going to talk about something else first because we got so excited last week. We just skimmed right over everything he wanted to talk about.
We did.
I didn't mind. I'm kind of ambivalent towards these things. And, so John says, well, you know what? We're going to move your topic over to this week. I'm like, I don't even remember my topic. What are you talking about?
We're literally going to do all his topics first so that way we don't gloss over.
So now you guys know not to tune in for the first 15 minutes, or otherwise tune out after.
I don't know. I think
depends on who you are.
I think these can be pretty good. So four great uses for your website that you're probably missing.
Yeah, and there's this was a fun thing to research because we've used a lot of these, but actually organizing them and putting them in this kind of a format. And I guess the article link will be. On the page when you're looking at it. But the idea of gathering leads on your website is incredibly important. And there's two things you can do. You have active and you have passive. And active is where you're saying, sign up for my newsletter, sign up for this and I'll send you this irresistible free offer, whatever that is. That's a very active thing. And people are saying, yes, please put me in. The passive way of doing it involves Facebook pixels. And anybody that visits your website using the same browser that they use for Facebook, it automatically captures their Facebook ID. And then they go into a little black box. You don't know who they are. but you can choose to advertise to them on Facebook after the fact. And right. so it is a really neat way to just continuously capture new leads, because these are people who've been to your website. Great. Then what you do is you go ahead and you advertise your irresistible free offer to them. And now that, you know, now you can get their email address.
The
because
irresistible
ultimately,
free offer.
Yeah, IFO. Yeah. IFOs are huge.
It's an offer you can't refuse.
It's an offer you can't resist.
Yeah.
But
so okay, so the Facebook pixel.
Yep.
How hard? Because I've talked to some people and they're like, oh, I put the pixel on there, I'm done. Then I get some people and I'm like, I can't figure it out.
No. It's a two-part process. One, you've got to go get your pixel code. Two, you need to install it in the header, or there are some really neat WordPress plugins that are, you know, Facebook pixel plugins. And all you do is install the plugin, and then it says, put your code here. And you hit it, you hit enter, it's like, okay, you're in. That's it. Okay? It depends on how hard you make it. Look, guys, the secret to website development, there's a plugin for everything. Okay? I mean, literally, I have been through so much stuff, and I'm like, how do I do this with the... Let me just check and see if there's a plugin. Oh, look, there's a plugin.
Yeah.
Okay? It's insane, you know?
I probably shouldn't say this, but I will out loud. On the front of our page, on WeBeam, you go to the very bottom. I can't figure out how to get rid of that, because I put the Google...
You
know,
short code.
Yeah. It says up in the bottom, like going, well, that sucks.
not quite
what I wanted.
They don't always work perfectly, but honestly, they may either help you along, and I will say the Facebook Pixel plugin, and here's the thing. If you're on WordPress and you're looking for the name of the plugin, it's really hard to remember. It's called Facebook Pixel. Okay.
Wow.
Yeah. And so it's super,
now,
super
how
easy.
Buried in that is it on your Facebook page?
You'll never see it. It's in the header.
No, no. I mean, where do you find it?
Oh.
Because sometimes you got to dig super deep.
No, you don't. No, you don't.
Really?
No.
Okay.
No, not at all. You install the plugin. You open the plugin. You put in the code. Hit save. You're done. That's it. It buries it everywhere it's supposed to be.
Oh, okay. So you go to your WordPress site.
Yes. Yeah, yeah,
and
yeah.
And then say...
Yeah, you come in through the back end.
And then you tell... And then you put your Facebook site on there.
Yep. Or you call us and you ask us to do it for you.
That's better. There can you take care of my friend?
Yeah, I can. So that's one. The other thing that people don't realize with a website is it... We all got into the habit of putting brochures up online.
Well, so that's what a lot of people thought websites were.
Exactly.
Nothing but a brochure.
Yeah, it's supposed to be an online brochure, you know, with your phone number, your address, your hours, blah, blah, blah. And, you know, and then hopefully they'll call, or hopefully they'll come in, and they'll find the place, they'll hit my map link. You know, honestly, all that information, you don't even need a website if that's what your goal is, because all of that's out there on either, you know, Apple Maps or Google Maps. You put it in there, you're done.
Right.
Okay. And so all that information is being found via another search engine, which they do have a website link available in those things. But honestly, it is that basic information is no longer really what you're out for. A website, I don't even call them websites when I'm talking with our clients. They're online marketing platforms. And what we do with them is we turn them into the sales process. We look at your what we call the DSO, the desired site outcome, which is when the prospective customer lands on your site, what do you want them to do?
Right.
Do you want them to schedule an appointment with you? Do you want them to pick up the phone and call you? Do you want them to fill out a questionnaire, okay, that lets them know whether your service is right for them? You know, what is your desired site outcome? And then we reverse engineer your website so that everything they do leads them straight to that point. Now what you've done is you've turned your website into a member of your sales staff.
That always shows up, is never sick, doesn't have
an attitude. Well, 99.7% of the time, guaranteed uptime if you use us. show me somebody else.
That is the sales pitch that we give people about digital signage.
Absolutely.
Because digital signage runs in your waiting room, whatever. It is a salesperson. Yep. It will soft up sale. It is a person that will always show up as long as your electricity is on. Yep. Doesn't have an attitude. Yeah.
No, has the exact same attitude you gave it on the day you hired it.
Boom.
And that's it. And it's the same thing with your website. I mean, your website never shows up grumpy. Okay, you know,
unless
never
you're
has
on the front
weekend.
Of it going,
and you know
I'm
what?
Grumpy today.
And you can adjust its attitude whenever
that
you want.
That is
exactly.
True.
If you need your website to be grumpy because too many fools are coming through, you go ahead and make it grumpy. You know, you make it a little bit harder to come through your filter. I don't really like to call them filters. I tend to think of them, I do call them filters. I don't like them to think of it as a funnel anymore. A funnel was like trying to catch people. Filters like, I don't want anybody that isn't exactly right for me. And that's what you're trying to do with the website is filter people. So that's number three. We've already talked a little bit about this, which is capture their information. But I want to circle back on that one because what you can do with their information is absolutely crucial. Once you have them saying, you know, they've come through all your filters, you've put out an a post that you wrote, it's an article, it's, you know, the seven ways to, you know, clean your pool without getting wet, you know, whatever it is you want to put out there, you put these things out there, and as they're going through it, it's kind of filtering them out further and further, and they're going, you know, if you'd like a quote on, you know, free on our free pool cleaning, whatever, I don't know.
Right.
Okay. You know, click here. You don't really want to be that much. If you want to find out, you know, what it takes to keep your particular pool, okay, in top-notch order, fill out this form. And in the form, you've got some questions. You know, what are the dimensions of your pool? Is it indoor, outdoor? Is it above ground, below ground? You know, all these kinds of things. When was it installed? You know, all these things can be in there. And you're gathering massive amounts of information now on the client. And why? Not because the client's going, my God, I can't wait to tell somebody this information. No, it's because they're sitting there saying, I really want to get the best right answer for me. So I'm going to give the most complete, accurate information I can.
Right.
And now what you're doing is you're starting a relationship with people, which leads us to our fourth point. Okay, the fourth thing that we can accomplish here. And this one is really good because it's no longer about a brochure that you hope people notice and will read and do all the work, and you're trying to shout at them with your benefit statements, and you're shouting at them with your headlines, and you're shouting at them with your warranties, promises, guarantees, and hold harmless agreements. You know, you're shouting, hoping that they listen, hoping that something sinks in. Instead, what you're doing is you're now conversing. So you're going to put out an article that says, hey, here's, you know, some intro stuff. And if you're interested, this is a whole category of stuff we have on this back at our website.
Yeah.
Okay. Now think about the first point, which was when people land on your website, what do? You capture them. Okay. And so you're going to capture them one way or another. Maybe they'll read enough stuff. They're ready to sign up for your newsletter today. Okay. Now you've got the information, or maybe they're ready to go on and fill out that form that gives them better, more customized information on what they're doing. And we are literally working on a case right now where, we have a doctor who is creating a test on the, on his website so that he can send, you know, prospective patients to it. And every score in the test, you know, their bands, everybody gets a different answer based on where they scored exactly on the test. Completely different recommendations for how they should deal with it. And, you know, it's really phenomenal what we're able to do with these things and really customize this stuff. But at this point, think about it, you're building a relationship with these people. And that is the most important thing you can do. A lot of people think that happens on Facebook. It doesn't. It happens on your online marketing platform.
Right.
Which used to be called, formerly known as website. Okay. And that's where you can build a relationship because we have another project we're working on right now whereby this is a nonprofit group that has, you know, hundreds of members. And so we've installed a new membership platform for them. And within the platform, you've got directories of everybody, so you can look up and see where they are, where they live, and you can, you know, not like exactly where they live, but you know what city they're in.
Right.
So if you know there's anybody around you. But then in addition, you can private message within the platform. We can set up groups within the platform. It's really phenomenal what we're able to do. And now what you've done is you've taken your audience and you own it. Because there is way too much crap going on right now with the social media platforms that have said, oh, bring us, you know, you're weak, you're sick, you're unwilling, you know, you're broke, you're whatever, okay, and put them all on here for free, and it's not free, and it's not free, and it's not free, and it's not only not free, but it's suddenly becoming not free.
Right.
Okay? They're censoring, they're editing. I mean, we had a point, you know, last week or the week before, where we were talking about Facebook accidentally, or was it, no, YouTube, you know, deleting 180,000, 160,000 videos.
Yep.
And then going, oh, maybe that was wrong of us. Okay. Yeah, it was always wrong of you. Okay. Section 230 says, no, you can't. And so, yes, you can have guidelines, but the vagueness with which they are interpreting these things and the people that are finding themselves targeted because of stuff they put on other posts and other comments they've made, this is a real problem because, you know, you may be running your page over here and it's running at your business, and then over here on your private, you belong to this group and somebody in this group makes a comment, you agree with it, or you repost it because you believe it has actual intellectual merit and you want to discuss it. We even had a case where somebody I know put up something that says, hey, I want people's opinions on this. I want to know what they think about it.
I wonder who he's
suddenly
talking about.
He's shut off. Which shuts him off from all of his web pages.
Right.
And so this is a serious, serious problem. And so being able to take that stuff and bring it home and owning your own community and owning the people and owning their communication and, you know, it doesn't take much. What it takes is, you know, the ability to say, this is important to me. I want to be here for these customers. That's why I'm doing this. And so you go ahead and you pull the trigger and you build something that allows you to build your own community. Because just like with your own email list, when you have your own community, you have something that is absolutely incredible. I was somebody I know is a psychologist, okay, who runs a group platform. He's got a book out and he's got a $500 membership. Okay, in order to get, you know, the annual coaching, da-da-da-da. What happens? He's in financial trouble because of COVID. So what's he do? He sends out a 60% off deal to his mailing list.
Right.
And bam, he goes from making $10,000 a month to making $30,000 this month because he's got this huge list he's built over time of all these people who never bought. Now the prices drop 60%. Now they're lining up and they're buying left and right.
Nice.
And he's able to make his car payments and pay his mortgage and get everything covered because he owns his list and he can do what he needs to do with it.
Right.
And when you own that information, when you own your own community, it's absolutely
okay,
it's
so
everything.
I got to ask you a question. So,
okay.
I used a product this weekend. I guess it's been around forever. In the gaming world, it's been around forever.
Okay.
Discord.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I always heard the kids screaming, sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't, blah, blah, blah. We're on this. So this weekend, we set up a test for myself because I wanted to see how it worked.
Oh, yeah.
We had a big wedding on the beach that we streamed. Mm-hmm. And a couple guys out there. So instead of bringing out the Telex, and burning crap loads of batteries, right, we set up a Discord server. Got everybody to log into the Discord call, and they're on their phones. So everybody had their earpieces in, whole nine yards, and it worked just great. So, but I also know that Discord, and it can be a way to communicate with your people.
Yep.
So yes. Is that something that would be, that
it,
would work?
It is an option, okay? You want to make it as simple as possible.
Right.
But you also want to make sure, I mean, Discord is, again, an outside service.
Right,
yeah.
Okay, it's not, they aren't your customers anymore. They're Discord's customers. And at any point there, you know, it's great if you got a lot of customers on Discord, just like you got a lot of customers on Facebook. That's great. Use those things as tools to drive them
to the website.
Back to your platform.
But you can embed that on the website, correct?
You can embed it on the website, but you can embed Facebook on a website. Okay, it's the same thing. It's an outside service. I'm talking about literally this nonprofit now owns the conversations. They own the list.
That's awesome.
They had a membership company on there, and this is another thing. If you're ever setting up your website and you're trying to do these membership things or auto emailers and all this stuff, and it says, connect to our outside service and get a subscription number and come back,
oh, they're
wrong.
Great.
That's just like Facebook. They now own all your customers. They own the list. They own the mailing information. They own every bit of financial information. Right. And you're handing it to another company when right. your clients are saying, I trust you with it.
Okay, so...
And you're not...
Same thing with...
So, you may not be being a good steward.
So we have GoDaddy as our... Yes. But you also yep. used another part of GoDaddy called...
Yes, called WeCraft Sites.
WeCraft,
yeah,
right.
Yeah, WeCraftSites.net is where you can go in and it is where we have all of the products you ever need, but you get our service built in as a layer in between you and GoDaddy, and it allows us to do to help you 100%.
No, that's a GoDaddy okay, all the way through. Though, right?
It is a GoDaddy product. What it is we are licensed GoDaddy sellers.
Got it. Well, they're partners with us.
Yeah, and so because of that, what it does is it allows us to help you run your whole site, regardless of the problem. It also helps that you follow our advice on how to set up your sites. Because I'm dealing with, you know, a customer right now up in Ocala, who they went ahead and they went through GoDaddy. Of course, they're not getting our kind of advice, and they set up on a WordPress, you know, WordPress site manager. They bought a WordPress site from GoDaddy. They have WordPress hosting as opposed to cPanel hosting. Now they've grown their site and they've got like 10,000 items for sale. They are just, they're making money hand over fist. I mean, they've just had two of the best weeks they've ever had in the middle of all this crap.
Right.
You know, they've just had amazing weeks and amazing months because everything's gone online. And so they've gone full bore behind it and they're doing great, except they're having trouble with the hosting account, with problems in the background because it's not actually geared. The WordPress hosting is designed for a brochure. There's your problem. Okay, it's designed for a very simple, you may have five items for sale, maybe you just got a map. You know, it's that kind of simple thing. Well, these people have thousands of items for sale in their catalog. And so they have discovered, now we have to go through a complete site migration to bring them over to where they should have been in the first place. Would have cost no different. Nothing was any, you know, maybe $20 a year difference.
Right.
Okay, but when you have the right kind of hosting in the background, then you have the ability to modify pieces of it, change it, grow it. And it's those particular technical questions that you may have that we then serve as your main line of defense in helping you decide what you need to do, what this change. You open up and your website's dead one day. All you got is a white screen saying there's an error. Oh my God, what happened? 99% of the time, you got a plugin with an error in it.
Right.
There's an easy fix for that, okay? And we can go ahead and we've been able to get those errors fixed in you know, minutes. But we need to be able to get into the back end to do that.
That's typical.
And that's what we're allowed to do yeah. when we use that platform.
So, yep. okay, so I'm going to, because I want one more thing on that world. We use YouTube.
Yeah, you're jumping there. Glad.
YouTube to embed
yep.
our videos.
Yep.
Because I know when I first came on with GoDaddy, and GoDaddy is part of WeBeam TV, you know, they're yep. one of our corporate backers. So they're like, first thing they said is, okay, you got to get rid of all the, because we used to host right. all of our videos on our server.
Right.
Terabytes of video. And they're like, no.
Nope.
So we got everything off and you put it on there. So now YouTube owns.
Google owns YouTube.
Yeah, but they're the one that's getting your data.
Yeah.
From all your subscribers.
Right. Right.
Do you get that as well?
No.
No.
No, not really.
No.
No. You can just have a nice long, you know, you have a big number next to your subscriber name and you right. can look down a list of it, but there really isn't jack squat you can do with it.
Right.
And that's a real problem, because if you're putting stuff out there and you are finding that, you know, you've got this great list of people that you love, the only thing you can do is go on a video and say, hi, please go to my Patreon account. Okay. Right. Now, granted, if they're watching and you are monetized, which, by the way, they changed the rules on that. I mean, back in the Wild West days of YouTube, it was great. You walked in, you started. Well, first of all, you couldn't have a video over 10 minutes. Remember that?
Oh, God,
Oh, yep. Those were the days. And everybody had, which is why when you see really old channels for you kids out there, you're wondering why you're seeing all these 10-minute, you know, portions of the movies you want to watch, and it has to roll. That's why. It's because you used to break them into 9 minute and 50 second segments and then go on to the next one, next one, next one. And that's why they invented the playlist. So you could just, you know, set the playlist to watch.
Exactly.
So that you could watch your movie and it would keep rolling to the next video because you're only allowed to upload 10 minutes. But that's the Wayback Machine right now. We're not going to go there.
Wayback Machine.
Yeah. Which is another website we'll get into at some other point. But in this case, it was great because if you went on there, you signed up, you could monetize, somebody watched your video, you made revenue.
Yep.
Okay, you made revenue. And then it's like, oh, well, now you have to have, you know, 10,000 views of your channel or else you can't monetize.
That's correct.
And, I mean, you look at that and it's like, okay, that may sound like, you know, oh, no big deal, 10,000, you're going to have one viral video. Yeah, good luck with that one viral video.
Yeah, it doesn't work okay? the way you say
it. It does not, you cannot plan it at all. I've been doing this too long, and I tell you what, you can see it if you monitor your own Facebook posts. This one here you think is dynamite. You think it's amazing. You think it's absolutely going to be, you know, just the cat's meow, okay? It's going to take off, and it gets, you know, 100 views. Total. Then you get another one that you like stole somebody's image, okay, because they posted it to a friend, you know, friends only. So you grabbed it and you put it over on your page because you thought it was a really great image and you put it over there. And now you got 9,000 freaking views on it. Okay. It's like, what was the difference? This is the one with the really good message. This one here is like, it's confusing. It's got grammar mistakes. You know, it's messy. And yet this one here has 9,000 views. Okay. And so you can't predict that crap.
Nope.
And so, but the main problem was trying to get to 10,000 views. And that takes a ton of work. And you're working for free.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You cannot monetize at that point where you're at. And, you know, it's really easy if you're not seeing any results to give up. You know, if you're getting 50 views on a video, can we do the math, please? Okay. You have to make 200 videos to get to 10,000 views. That's a lot of freaking videos. And unless you want to pollute your channel with garbage content, hoping that somebody will like that picture of a cat, okay,
right.
You know, laying in the sunspot, okay, that's not what you want when you're trying to build your brand. So, yeah, YouTube has upped its requirements. I won't say it's upped its game, because in a lot of ways it's downed its game. But it's just become the barriers to entry on YouTube have gotten really high.
And yeah. and so not that we're trying to push you away from YouTube, you know, but there are some other platforms out there, right,
yeah,
that are challenging.
Yep. And a lot
YouTube.
Of people know about Vimeo.
But the problem is all of these. Now I'm looking at these. Now the one we're going to talk about the most, I don't know about.
Yeah.
But there's Vimeo. There's Rumble. Right.
Oh, I've never heard of. That's the one we're going to talk about.
Yeah. Yeah. And there's JW Player and Bright Cove. First of all, Bright Cove is a place where you park and pay.
Yes.
So is JW Player.
Yep.
Park and play.
Yep.
Don't know anything about Rumble.
Now, when you do that, okay, you get 100% of the revenue that comes in from your ads. They don't take any cut. You get it all.
Right, right.
Okay. That's pretty cool.
And then there's Vimeo. I didn't know you make money off of Vimeo.
You can. I mean, but the thing about Vimeo is it gives you really good quality distribution control. Okay. You can lock those channels down and really customize the player option.
Well, so I know people that have used Vimeo. They use that for their pay to play.
Exactly.
So if you're going to watch it, you know, you got to pay, you get a code, blah, blah, blah. Which is great, right?
Yep.
I mean, you can't do that
with
YouTube.
And you get
to
keep the money. Have a nice day.
Okay. Yeah, but it's expensive.
Yeah, it can be.
Very.
Depending upon what you're loading. And again, it's a dice roll.
Right. And then with JW Player, I knew JW Player was for is when you embedded your own video.
Yeah.
If you didn't know how to use HTML.
Right.
Right. Or, you know, you pick a player or something like that.
Yeah.
That plays. Bright Cove. Now, I know Bright Cove is because Bright Cove has been around the streaming world for a long time because it allows you to stream and park. I can go to MailChimp. I mean, not MailChimp, but I can also go to StreamMonkey and use their back ends. Well, hey, that's who we use.
I know. But
and they're part
of MailChimp, StreamMonkey. I see why you got it wrong.
Right. But they're part of Akamai. So
Primate Video.
Until we start running 5 million viewers monthly, we can't. We don't qualify for Akamai.
No.
I mean, we do, but I'm not going to pay that kind of money.
No.
So So no. To me, now let's talk about Rumble. But I have never heard of Rumble.
No, and I tell you what, I stumbled upon it, and I was
stumbled upon a Rumble?
Yeah, it was the Rumble stumble.
Let's get ready to
and
stumble.
I was incredibly impressed. First of all, they've been out there fighting for this for 5 or 6 years now.
And they're a Canadian company.
They're a Canadian company. They're one of the top 20 fastest growing Canadian companies. They have been battling this spot for, you know, to fight against YouTube. Imagine YouTube in the Wild West days, and this is where you're at. Except you actually, and this is what's really amazing, when you do an actual cost comparison, not cost comparison, a revenue comparison between the two platforms, Rumble pays you 10 times what YouTube pays you.
But what does it cost to be on Rumble?
Nothing. Absolutely nothing. I went out, opened a channel, started uploading, and I've already got money in my account in 5 days.
Really?
That is a hell of a difference. Mm. Okay? Now, and within there, you can they give you embed codes. So you can put those codes straight over into your website. And then anybody that lands on your website, guess what? They're going to be paying you money now just for watching on your website. So your own videos can now pay you. It is phenomenal what you're able to
do. They have playlists, all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, you can do all the fun stuff, okay? It is a phenomenal platform. And here's the deal. It is actually literally Section 230 compliant. They do not censor. Now, you will not be able to monetize something with profanity. I thought that was really neat. Okay, if it's got profanity, you can't monetize it. Have a nice day. They want to keep it clean.
Canadian, eh?
User-friendly, eh?
They're super
yeah,
nice,
Canadian.
Eh?
Yeah, good day, eh? Take off to the great white north. Okay. And who caught the fact that Bob and Doug were the astronauts? Okay. Yeah. I thought that was brilliant. that just came back from, the.
Listen here, bank. Hoser.
But Hoser. So these are Rumble as it plays out, flawless player. Found it fantastic. Okay, it streams beautifully, it runs beautifully, you go right there, the menu is so easy to use. I just go up, open my account, look at my revenue, have a nice day. Okay, not all this crap where it's buried 19 pages in. I mean, it's literally intuitive and user-friendly. I want to upload a video, boom, upload a video. Choose your license. Choose your license. You don't get one YouTube license and that's it. For everybody, you choose the license you want. Do you want other people to be able to share your video? Do you want you only can use it? Do you want to monetize it? Do you not want to monetize it? You got 4 license choices when you log in. He even said this one is the most like YouTube, you know, in parentheses. So it makes it really, really easy to understand where you're at.
This is the most like YouTube.
Yeah. And it's phenomenal what you're able to do.
We couldn't use it because some of my shows have cursing in it.
Yeah. And so it would be. It,
but how does it work with the? So I.
Well,
I know,
no. You can use it. You can't monetize it. That's all.
Yeah.
And you're not monetizing anyway.
No, because we just don't. But how does it work with the search engines? Being not a Google product.
Oh, well, of course,
YouTube
Google,
being on your website.
Well, Google is completely fair. They never, ever, ever prioritize their own products against everyone else. And I want you to know that every word I just said is absolutely a lie.
I was going to say, okay? You're not believing that crap,
found,
are you?
They have been found, busted, fined. I mean, this is exactly what they do. And you know what? It doesn't matter anymore because the search engines are going away. I know most people think that's crazy, but the fact is we are now on Web 2.0. And with Web 2.0, you don't care about search engine results or search results optimization. You don't care about that crap anymore because you're going out, you are using social media in whatever way.
Right.
Maybe you're using Parlay or Parlor, depending upon who you talk to. Maybe, and instead of, your standard chats and so
right.
on, you're using Signal, okay, and you're using Rumble. And you're building a community right there with all those outlets, and you're bringing people over. You can still use Facebook to drive people. You can use LinkedIn. You can use whatever you want to drive people to your site, because guess what? Your site is your home base.
Right.
Your site is where you're focused.
I've said that for years. I've had people go, you have a website? Nope, I have Facebook.
I have Facebook. Then you have nothing.
You don't have anything.
No, you don't, because they can decide one day. And I can't tell you. I mean, you know what? That same client up in Ocala, many moons ago, they had set up their store page as a personal page. And we know there's still there. It's still out there. And you'll see them. They're your friends on Facebook, and it's the name of a store or the name of a business. And they had 800 followers, 800 friends, because they were gaming the system. They logged in their business as a friend. But back then, we didn't know. This is 10, 12 years ago. Okay, what's the right way to do this? Didn't know how to create a page. And so they started it that way. And one day, Facebook woke up and realized it and just erased the account.
Yeah.
800 Ooh. Fans, followers of their business, gone.
Yeah, I remember
yep.
that. They were.
Yeah, that was. It was just like they just.
They converted. They converted the personal page into a business page, and that was it.
That's what they did to me.
And lost everyone.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
I still have. But mine are still like friends.
Yeah. Well, they'd be friends of yours, but not friends of your page. The account was deleted.
Oh, well, that's
okay.
Sucks.
Yeah, that's it was just wrong. Gone. And so they had to go out and start advertising and building their numbers back up again. Now they're in 8,000-10,000 range. Okay.
People don't understand. Again, everything that you're talking about, though, same situation. It's somebody else's platform.
Exactly.
And so, like with John, when he makes his videos, he doesn't just upload them to the internet and make them disappear. He saves everything.
Yep.
And there's a reason for that.
Yep.
Again, like with Anthony saying, moving over to a different platform. If you've taken all your videos, uploaded it to YouTube, for instance, erased your list of videos, your storage devices, or whatever, or just streamed everything, then you're stuck where you're at.
You have nothing.
You have nothing, and they own everything.
Yes.
If you could made it or not, it's irrelevant because they can just go delete, and you're done for.
Yep, and you're all gone. So. And sometimes that can happen by accident, which really sucks.
Depends on who you made mad.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, that's
accident. So these are the things like Rumble. I'm looking at this thing and I'm loving it. I am absolutely loving it. I love the players. I love the people behind it are very, very much about keeping it as an open platform, and they are committed to not having a blacklist of users. And you're not going to get away with terrorist stuff, you're not going to get away with violence, and you're not going to be able to monetize something with foul language. I love that idea. Because that's just not who they want to be, and I don't have a problem with that.
Right.
Yeah. So
normally
push
I don't, but unfortunately, I have some shows that are not perfectly clean. So
no.
So we're going to jump into a tech world. I put this in here for you.
Yeah.
Okay. So this EVGA came out was the NVIDIA RTX 3080 card. It's the capacitors are causing crashes. Now I asked about this when they first announced they were going to come out with this, and they were pushing it out fast.
Yeah.
I'm like, can the systems actually handle this piece of hardware?
It looks like they looks like their own card couldn't handle itself.
Right? Well, I didn't want to say that, but
what it is remember, NVIDIA licenses the chipset itself to different vendors. So that's just EVGA, for instance. So luckily EVGA is having that issue now. So as the different vendors, OEM vendors that build the card will finally say, oh, well, if they're having an issue with this particular capacitor layout, we're going to go ahead and take a double take at it. And it doesn't mean that there's a problem with the card. When NVIDIA says, okay, look, this is what's needed, the power requirements and stuff, and this is what's needed to run this chip.
Right.
And when they're building the technical specifications for the card, they'll say, okay, it takes a capacitor that has, this much, this many farads, it's got to have this capacity, this many volts per capacitor. But a lot of times, your vendors will go out, they'll go out there and they'll be like, oh, well, we found a capacitor that's capable of doing this. It might be a really low quality capacitor that has a real short lifespan, for instance, a quick charge.
Mm-hmm.
It could have too fast of a discharge, for instance.
Right.
So when, for instance, you're getting ready to play a new game and the capacitor's discharged too quickly before ramping up the processor, then there's where an error, you know, an issue will cause, you know, the instability for the, you know, video card.
Okay.
Starts blue screening, you know, crashing, things like that. Now they're, unfortunately, they're going to have to, you know, factory recall, you know, they're going to have to recall those cards from people who probably did a lot of pre-orders, and they're going to have to, you know, they're going to be refurbishing them and sending them back out. So one good thing about this is you might be able to find a card at a really good price pretty soon when you find a factory refurbished
right.
3080. So, and just remember, if it says factory refurbished, you know, they've gone through the card a second time. They've, you know, they'll take off the bad capacitors. They'll replace them. Most of the time, the card will be a lot better than it was.
When it rolled out. So they fixed all the bad stuff.
Yeah, they're going to fix it. And they've already said that they found a capacitor, the capacitors that are causing it. I guess it was six of them in a group that was causing a problem. They've already isolated that issue. They're just going to replace them and be done.
That's awesome.
That's it.
But I just, you know, I knew, you know, I'm like, when they rushed, because they rushed it out.
Yeah, they did. Yeah. They did.
They pushed that thing out.
They talked about it.
Wow.
They talked about it. They had people out there testing it. It was out.
Right. Then it's out. Right.
Yeah.
It's like, okay, here we go.
I mean, how many beta testers did they have really, you know, testing the card out?
They didn't have that many.
Probably fewer than they had bad capacitors on the board.
That's great.
Which, you know, honestly, I really think the name of that little group there should be called the Dirty Half Dozen.
The Dirty Half Dozen. That's awesome.
They were very noisy capacitors.
All right, so in the world of this pandemic crap, we all have started using Zoom,
right.
Microsoft Meetings, and then Google Meet. There's out there, right? And so, so I think Google didn't learn fast enough to go, that's why Zoom is limiting everybody to 45 minutes on a free account. So as of September 30th, Google will meet the meeting limit to 60 minutes.
Yep, which only makes sense.
You gotta cut down on the bandwidth.
Think about it. You got people just leaving it on all day. At that point, if it's free, who cares?
Yeah,
right.
Okay, and it's the same thing as having, you know, free electricity. You know, everybody's air conditioner is set at 65.
Well, you gotta figure.
And in the winter, the heat is set to 80. Nobody cares, you know.
See, you got to figure too, you know, like Google Classroom and stuff. You know, the kids will leave the throw that in there. The kids will be just they'll leave up the player.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah, they'll just be on all day.
Yeah,
yep.
No, it's poor planning on their part, and I can't believe that with all of their data. I want you to think, Google knows everything about virtually every human being on this planet,
right?
And they don't know anything apparently about actual human nature. All that data, and they make it unlimited free. What the hell are you thinking? You know, I mean, it's
well,
like, yeah,
it's
come
just
on.
Because most of the developers and everybody live in their, you know, parents'
basement.
In their little utopia where they don't pay for the bandwidth or their phones even.
They've forgotten about the one basic thing, human nature. They don't understand it. And that in itself, and I will say this when it comes to the gaming world, when it comes to the tech world, that in itself, okay, is very disheartening and very scary because how quickly people misconstrue things or you could only understand it by facial expression.
Right.
There's some things that even unspoken language can make you understand that John was telling me a joke and he was being funny about it and he wasn't being serious. But in a text message, it may come off in the wrong manner, or even on the internet, for instance,
right.
or on social media,
okay.
You know, where people take things the wrong way, and it happens way too much today.
Way too much.
It's very easy to do, and I mean, it's one of the beautiful things that we have the video conferencing now. We have these video transmissions. We're able to hold video meetings. That's really great, and it's helped a lot. But it has also led to a whole new skill set for people.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, how to dress from the waist up, you know. But
we're in TV. We've been doing that for years. That's nothing new. I'm just saying.
And just to prove to you how incredibly talented we are, we have waist down shots today.
Yeah, okay?
Yeah, yeah. We're giving you everything. But
we are clothed.
But there really is a whole new skill set that goes along with that. And, you know, learning how to, you know, how to behave in front of a camera and how to control the environment behind you. Because you walk into a conference room, you don't care.
Right.
Now, if you're really sharp and you go into a conference room, you always position yourself in front of the window. Especially if it's a sales presentation of any type. Here's a little key for you people out there. If you are in any kind of negotiation, anything, always position yourself with the back to the window. Because that gives you a clear focus point within the room, and it puts your opponent at a disadvantage because they are constantly being distracted by what's outside. They lose their train of thought. It has been proven you can close many more deals with your back to the window than you can with your back to the wall.
Or a TV. Put yourself in front of a TV.
Whatever it is. Okay.
Distractions.
Yep. Put the distraction behind you. And
make
so
sure you know what these you're watching are back there.
Little tricks. You think I ain't learned nothing in 35 years of this? but
when I was your age.
Yeah.
When I was your age, back in the day.
I don't remember when I was
so
your age.
Do you have an Apple Watch?
Yes, I do.
Do you have an Apple Watch? All right. So Apple Watch Series 3 users complained of a random reboot.
Yes.
And other bugs after updating to Watch OS 7.
And it was
have you updated?
I don't have a 3.
Oh, okay.
Yep.
Yes, I seen it firsthand, and I had to. I started digging into it right off the bat, and the Apple forums were filling up with complaints that the Apple Watch 3 was crashing. It was just literally what was happening and what I seen happening would middle of the day just out of the blue, especially if it was switching between networks, like cellular or Wi-Fi. A lot of times when you left the house or left a Wi-Fi connection that you were connected to and it switched to cellular or Bluetooth, the unit was basically, you know, fully crashing and then rebooting or getting stuck in the boot.
Right.
And it was just staying there at the Apple logo, would not do a darn thing. Very frustrating. Very, very frustrating.
Did you have to do a hard shutdown on the watch?
No, eventually it would come up. Soon after I read up on it, within about 3 days, Apple released a new update. Now, there's a 14.01 update.
Yep.
There was it's Watch OS 7, I think it is. It's what we're on. So 7.01. There was an update for that.
Yeah, I've already updated all my stuff. So, there's a new Catalina update too. That's how I think it's Catalina.
I want one. I've now that I don't do a lot of production work like we used to do, where my hands are in truss and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
I told you the horror story, right? Of why I don't wear watches.
Yeah,
my hands, we were lifting this big truss, massive truss, right? And I had to control a cable because it kept getting hung. So every would go up, they'd bring it back down. So I thought I'd just hold it. Well, the operator wasn't paying attention to me, and my hand got twisted, and I got caught by my watch and couldn't let go. And I was dangling like 7 feet in the air before the guy really realized. I was screaming my guts out, you know, to stop and put me down. He went, "Oh my God!" So after that, I stopped wearing a watch altogether.
Yeah, a lot of guys in machine shops and so on, they wear absolutely no jewelry because you get a finger caught in a CNC machine. Okay, I mean, there's all kinds of things that can go on. You wear no jewelry, but this is so nice because in a meeting or you know, if you've been watching the program long enough, you've seen me. Okay, my phone's ringing, I'm like, boom, and I completely turn it off and it's done. And that's all you do. It is so seamless. You're not picking up a phone, you're not doing anything, but you get a text message, you can just glance down and see who it is, what they're saying, how important it is, and then blow it off. And so you're not really losing it in the meeting. Now, however, if you're in the previous situation where you're in the close with the window behind you because you listened, okay, you turn off your notifications. But aside from that, I find it to be incredibly useful in that aspect. And so we're married at the wrist.
Yeah, I always had a problem when I was in meetings with people and they'd look at their watch. And I'm
now it doesn't mean they're bored. Now it just means somebody called them.
Well, yeah. And so, I mean, I got the point in times where I would just stop talking.
Yeah.
And then they would go, something wrong? I'm like, yeah, obviously something's more important on your watch.
You know, I will say that since the advent of the Apple Watch.
Dude, I refused. I'm done. We're done because you're not paying attention to me. We can just call this meeting done. No. I'm like, oh, yeah. I said, or the people that do this.
Yeah. See, that's what it prevents, okay, is that thing.
But it doesn't. You're still doing this.
Yeah, you do that.
I mean, unless yeah. you've got it backwards and you can, to me, it's like the minute someone, if they're that distracted by a watch or a phone, I'm out. I'll walk away from it because that means that's the kind of person that I could sit there and go, okay, this is what we're going to need, blah, 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 blah. And then they're going to say, well, you never told me that.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah, I did, possible. But you were too busy looking at your watch.
I think we're all building skill sets in these areas, though. Just like with how we video conference, we're also building the check, make sure I can stay focused because there's not an emergency,
right.
okay, that I'm missing and I'm thinking about. Because right. if you've had the buzzer go off in your pocket and it's gone off twice, you're sitting there going, crap,
yeah, who's
what's
trying to
wrong?
Get hold of me? Yeah.
What is the emergency? And you have to pull your phone out to look. Whereas you can go, no, it's junk mail.
Okay.
And yeah. you're done.
Well, I mean, I've started a new thing now that we just put out last week is we will now come to your office or come to your home, right? And we will help you set up a Zoom or a conference camera.
Right.
The correct way.
Right.
I was
the nose shots? Dang.
So I was talking, we're going to go there. I mean, I have something up. We're going to talk about XP if we get to it. So I mentioned to a person that I said, look, the world's gone to Zoom and blah, blah, blah. And we're going to start a new thing where we're going to go and we're going to teach people how to be proper on Zooms.
Right.
That means no up the nose. That means no virtual backgrounds unless you have a something behind you that's lit well.
And so solid.
So it will work.
Yep.
Right? We're going to, you know, lights, presence, having headsets, having a microphone. And for businesses, it's $250
yep.
for it to come show up. But that $250 is multiple trips out there because I'm going to come out, see what you've got. I'm going to give you your list. You're going to buy your stuff. Then I'm going to come back and help you set it up. So it's not just like I'm going to go out there for 30 minutes and then walk away.
Right.
It's a multiple trip. That's why it costs.
Right.
I'll even do one for the homes, as long as it's local, for $99. But here's the thing. This person said to me, well, you know, we're just in networking meetings, and it really kind of doesn't, it's not a big deal. We all know each other. I said, really? I said, so the whole member back in the day, you dress for the job you want.
Right.
You dress to impress.
That's right.
You never show up looking like, I mean, I know I've got this on, but I'm trying to really brand nerd talk, and I'm trying to bring it apart. Actually, we have Tech Shaman shirts coming. So it's really important. I've been on Zoom meetings where I swear I crap you not. Chicks, this girl had big ass boobies. She wore short skirts. She puts her freaking laptop down there, and then she does this. Ready? And walks away. So not only do you see the boobs, but you see a crotch shot, and then she walks away. She didn't know to turn her freaking camera off, and it's a god awful shot. Or the other day, I saw one on national TV. National TV. The guy was sitting, his phone was on the table, and he was looking over it like this. I'm like, I wouldn't take you serious if my life depended on it.
Right.
Seriously, there comes a point in time where we've got to be professional. Even in these networking meetings, even if we know everybody.
Yeah.
You got to be.
Yep.
And people are. You know, with me, I'm on 3 meetings a week. And you know the meetings I'm talking about. I'm a WPBA, and there's a couple of RGA and all these kinds. If I can't pay attention to who's talking, I will turn my camera off, and then I need to do, and then I can listen to what's going on. So I'm not distracting to the person that's talking.
Right, you're being courteous.
That's a courteous thing. Here, man, these people are just, they're talking to other people.
Yep.
Right.
Yep.
Or they're on their phone, or a dog comes up and licks them on the face, or blah blah. Now every now and then a dog. I'm cool with having a dog.
Yeah, I know.
I'm good with that.
Animals are always welcome.
But when you get up away from your Zoom or your communications, turn your camera off. I cannot believe that I was in that, and she literally stood up, and you saw right in her crotch. I'm like,
yeah.
Hope someone's recording this, because that needs to be shown to her. Or you don't sit in front of a window, And this yep. thing, this time you don't shut yeah. it down because then you can't.
Or the backlighting thing about a window. I mean, the last thing you want to be is a silhouette in your Zoom conference.
Yeah.
And there's so many people that end up doing that. They've got really bright backgrounds. They've got windows behind them. They've got, you know, a giant white wall behind them and no light on their face, you know, because the lights are behind them or something. And you end up with a silhouette.
So if you're yeah. doing a ton of these, you need to call me. Or call one of my guys, and we'll come out and we'll help you set up. We'll let you go through your house or your office with you, and help you set up a yep. nice background. People have them; they just don't know they have them.
So, it's amazing to see some of the actual pullbacks you see from mm-hmm. some of these interviews. You know, people they're doing. There's a beautiful plant here. There's nothing here. There's a little hanging here, and you pull back. And it's like, I saw this one the other day. First of all, the person's only dressed from here up, then it's shorts.
Yeah.
Okay. But then the iPad is on top of the coffee table, which is then on top of a laundry basket. Okay, so it's up at the right height. And there's like laundry and crap all over the couch. Like the whole room is a pigsty, except for this one area of the wall. That's it. But that's all it has to be.
Yeah. It's just that one.
You don't want to see what's over here, guys. You don't want to see
nope.
it. Except for the fact that actually looks really good.
So about the minute and a half left, we're going to talk about the funniest, the cutest thing ever.
Speaking of, yes.
So science shows that watching cute animals is good for your health.
I'm going to go ahead and put up videos of our baby goats.
Baby goats are awesome.
Oh, yeah. Ours are so cute.
Absolutely cool.
Are they the fainting goats, though?
No.
Nah.
No.
Those are even more hilarious.
No. Actually, we have a real problem.
George, get over here. George, get over here. Damn it, George.
George,
so anyway, that was great show. Great show. Thanks for watching today. We have a lot of information. Tech Shamans at WeBeamTV.com if you've got any. And actually, we're getting ready to start a Discord so our people can follow us on Discord.
Yeah.
We want to thank everybody for watching. David Yoakum was watching. David is the guy that allowed me to bring the alien into the studio. I don't know if you've seen the Facebook post with me and the alien.
Yes.
Everybody freaking loves it.
I think I missed
that one. You have to take a picture of it.
I will go find it.
Nick Briggs is watching and Crystal was watching. We had a lot of people watching today. We appreciate
it. Thank you.
We know you have a lot to watch. We know we're at 11 o'clock, which is kind of weird time, middle of the day. But like it, share it, tell your friends about us. If you have any questions or comments or something you want to talk about, put it in techshamans@webeamtv.com or just Facebook message us and we'll get it. So we'll see everybody next week. Have a great week.
Ciao, folks.
See ya.
It's far out and technical and stuff.
Awesome.
Yeah. Come on and turn it on. Tune into the Tech Shamans. Come on and turn it on. Tune into the Tech Shamans. Come on and turn it on. Tune into the Tech Shamans. Come on and turn it on. Tune into the Tech Shamans. Cool.